Welcome to Crayola Creativity Week. Today's theme is weathering emotions. Our special guests are Dylan Dreyer and Rosie Butcher. Hi there. We're excited that you'll be talking to us about weather and emotions today.
Hi, Mateo.
Hi.
Dylan, please introduce yourself and tell students about your exciting career.
Hi, everyone. I am Dylan Dreyer. I am a meteorologist for NBC News. I'm the co-host of the third hour of the Today Show, and I am also the author of the Misty the Cloud series. And I, as a meteorologist, loved math and science. I actually went to school to study to be an engineer, but I always had a passion for the weather. I loved looking up at the sky and hearing thunderstorms. And I decided, hey, there's a lot of math and science in meteorology. And I decided to follow that career path instead.
Rosie, please introduce yourself and tell students when and why you set your mind on being an illustrator.
Hiya, I'm Rosie Butcher. I'm the illustrator of the Misty the Cloud books, and I wanted to be an illustrator ever since I grew up surrounded by books, reading, experimenting with art products, and I like to tell my own stories with my own drawings. And that's what eventually led me to want to tell stories as a job and be an illustrator.
Dylan, please explain the overarching theme of the book you wrote. Misty the Cloud, A Very Stormy Day.
When I decided to write this story, I thought it would be really fun to use my knowledge of the weather and my knowledge of emotions and how we feel, because I'm a meteorologist, but I'm also a mom of three young boys, a five-year-old, a two-year-old, and a one-year-old. So I study weather all day long, and I also study my kids' emotions and their feelings all day long too. And there's this really cool connection between weather and feelings. I mean, think about it. Sometimes we use the word turbulent to describe the atmosphere and everything's all churned up, but we can also use turbulent to describe our emotions sometimes, like when we're frustrated or angry. There's all those turbulent emotions inside of us. And just like we see after a thunderstorm passes, the sun can return, the clouds clear, and things feel calmer. Just like when our stormy mood passes, we can feel calmer after that too. So I understand what it's like to have those emotions, and sometimes you don't know what to do with them. But if you can compare them to the weather, like the weather you see when you look out the window, maybe you can understand your emotions a little bit more.
Dylan, before you read the book, please show us the characters who are featured on the inside cover and explain what their names represent.
Oh, I would love to, because we put a lot of thought into naming the characters of our book. And I really wanted all the names to have something to do with weather or have something to do with a descriptor of a cloud. Like wispy, for example, you know, you look outside and you see some of those wispy clouds that kind of just kind of paint the sky in white. You know, they're not too thick. They're not too stormy. We've got scud, which is an actual type of cloud. It's called a scud cloud. And it's those little puffs of clouds you see in the sky. They're fairly harmless, those scud clouds. NIMBY, we thought would be a fun take on a cumulonimbus cloud. That's a big word, cumulonimbus, but it basically means a thunderstorm. So NIMBY is the youngest character of the bunch. He's Scud's little brother. So we thought it would be a cute little spin on cumulonimbus to name him NIMBY. Kelvin is actually my favorite name because I have a son named Calvin, and Kelvin is actually a measurement of temperature, just like the Fahrenheit scale or the Celsius scale. Kelvin is a measurement of temperature, so I thought that kind of coincided with the weather. Misty was the hardest name to come up with because she's our main character, and we really wanted her to encompass all things clouds, but we didn't want to call her Cloudy, or, you know, we had a whole bunch of other different names. But, you know, clouds are actually made up of mist. They're made up of water droplets. So I thought it would be a lot of fun to just name her Misty because it kind of sums up what all clouds are.
Dylan, you have piqued our interest in the book. Please read Misty the Cloud, A Very Stormy Day.
Well, I'm so glad. I'd be happy to. Here it is, Misty the Cloud, A Very Stormy Day. Claire stepped into the batter's box. She looked up and smiled. Perfect weather for our game. Not a single cloud in the sky. But there was a cloud in the sky, far beyond where Claire could see. That cloud's name was Misty, and she was a few thousand feet above the ball field, out over the horizon, in a town named, what else? Horizon. Misty wasn't smiling at all. In fact, she was having a miserable day. That morning, Misty had been fast asleep, dreaming about happy things. For example, the colorful balloons that often soared up from the earth, when an airplane whizzed by, waking her from her dream. How rude. And that made Misty feel, well, a little stormy. Misty usually enjoyed reading, but today it wasn't making her feel better. So she decided to look for a friend to play with instead. Wispy will cheer me up, she thought. He knows how to have fun. Wispy was a bundle of energy, always clowning around. Hey, Wispy, want to play sky tag? Misty called. I'd like to, he called back, but my mom says I have to get an early start on my spelling homework. Later, math. After that, science. Wispy. I know, I'm sorry. Misty understood, but not being able to play made her even stormier. Oh no, where did that cloud come from? It better not rain on our game, Claire said. Go away, cloud, please go away. But Misty didn't go away. In fact, her mood was about to get even more turbulent. She went to find her pals Scud and Kelvin, hoping they would play with her. But Scud couldn't join her for sky tag either. He had to stay home and help take care of his brother Nimby. And Kelvin had to get new glasses, the kind with built-in windshield wipers. Very handy for a cloud made of water droplets. Misty's mood turned unsettled with a chance of rain. She couldn't help herself. She yelled. And every time Misty yelled, lightning flashed, thunder boomed, rain poured down. Today that meant, uh-oh, game over. Of course, that made Claire very upset, almost as upset as Misty way up in the sky. Claire stamped her feet and stomped around the house. She was mad. Misty, what's the matter? A voice called out. Mom, this is the worst day ever, Misty said. She told her mother about the airplane and how upset she was that her friends were too busy to play. You think that everything has gone wrong, dear. That's made you stormy. And being stormy has made you even stormier. Yes, Misty sniffled. Remember, Misty, the more you grumble, the more you'll rumble. But the rhyme didn't lift Misty's spirits. I'm mad and upset, and I'm going to stay mad and upset, Misty thundered back. Forever? Her mother asked. Forever, Misty boomed. There's nothing that can cheer you today? Misty's mom wanted to know. Nothing. Not even those hot air balloons? Oh, wow, my favorite, Misty beamed. They're so beautiful, and they're coming this way. Misty was cheered by the balloons and her stormy mood passed. She started shrinking until she looked like herself again. Even better, her friends floated over. Ooh, balloons, Wispy said. Balloons, Kelvin shouted. Balloons, said Scud as he joined his friends. Spoons, gurgled Nimby, not quite able to say balloons. Mom, look, Claire said, pointing skyward. That cloud looks happy again. No more gray sky, no more thunder, no more lightning. Could we go outside and practice? Already got my glove, her mother said. Not a storm cloud as far as the eye can see, Claire exclaimed. I predict that the rest of the day will be great. And this time, she was 100% right. So while I love the story, my favorite part, since I'm a meteorologist, is to give you some fun weather facts. So this time, in this book, all the weather facts are about thunderstorms and why thunderstorms happen. So, it all starts with warm air and cold air. So that's why we have here, hi, I'm warm air. I like sunshine and southerly winds. I weigh less than cold air because I'm lighter, not as dense. And this balloon says, hello, I'm cold air. I like northerly winds and I'm heavier than warm air. So here's the thing, when warm air rises, it cools and condenses into a cloud. When lots of warm air rises, it cools and condenses into a cumulonimbus cloud. When warm air rises and cold air sinks within a cloud, it creates static electricity, and that electricity is released as lightning. Did you know, this is one of my fun facts, lightning is 5 times hotter than the surface of the sun. Lightning is 53,540 degrees Fahrenheit, and the surface of the sun is only 10,340 degrees Fahrenheit. So we talked a lot about different weather terms in the book, especially the word turbulence and turbulent. So turbulence is irregular motion caused by currents. It's kind of when air goes all around in all different directions. So imagine if air was in a blender and it was getting tossed and turned up and down and all around, then you'd say it was turbulent. Well, when people are in a turbulent mood, their feelings are turned up and down and all around. An updraft is an upward current of air, like rising warm air, and a downdraft is a downward current of air, like falling cold air. And cumulonimbus is a towering cloud formed by powerful updrafts, often with a head that's shaped like an anvil. In many cases, it's a thundercloud. And then Misty says here, all this up and down is making me dizzy. Rightfully so, since she's a cloud after all. So static electricity, we talked about static electricity and how that's the type of energy that's released from a thunderstorm. Well, static electricity is an electric charge that's produced by friction. So in a storm cloud, intense updrafts and downdrafts create static electric sparks in the form of lightning. Remember that blender of air I just told you about a moment ago? Well, as the air moves in all directions, it creates static electricity. Just like if you've ever rubbed a balloon on your hair and your hair sticks out, that's also static electricity. So little static makes a snap. So sometimes imagine if you run across the floor in your socks and then you touch a doorknob and you get that little spark, that's a little mini version of static electricity being released. But big static makes a clap. So those big sparks on a much bigger scale in a thunderstorm, that creates lightning. So that's why I say here, little static makes a snap and big static makes a clap. So now that we know all our weather terms and everything we need to know about thunderstorms, here are some activities you can do. First, count on it. Whenever you see lightning, make sure you get indoors. But then when you see that bolt of lightning, start counting. Stop counting when you hear the thunder. Divide that number by 5, and that's how many miles away the storm is. So let's say you see lightning, and you count all the way till 10 until you actually hear that thunder. You divide 10 by 5, and you get 2, and that means the storm is 2 miles away from where you are. The 30-30 rule. If you can't count to 30 seconds between a flash of lightning and a thunderclap, the storm is close enough to be a threat. Wait 30 minutes after the last rumble of thunder before you head back outside, because thunderstorms are dangerous, so you want to make sure you stay inside for the right amount of time until they pass. So here's a fun activity you can also do at home. You can make thunder with a paper bag. So when air near a lightning bolt is heated up, the air is forced so rapidly in many different directions that it makes a sound. That sound is thunder, and it's all because of the heat of the bolt of lightning. Well, if you blow air into a paper lunch bag, and then you close it and pop it, and it makes that loud popping sound, that air is also being forced in many different directions very rapidly. It also makes a sound, and you just created mini thunder. So that's a fun way to do it at home. And we like to end our books with a little poem, a little summary of what we just learned in the book, this time back to our emotions again. So something to remember, you can't control the weather, but you can control your mood. When you're feeling bad, no need to sulk or brood. Find joy in things around you. Take a deep breath, count to 10, and you'll soon find you're living under sunny skies again. And that's the end.
Dylan, this story has many important lessons to remember. Like, you can't control the weather, but you can control your mood. What advice do you suggest for weathering emotions?
Well, I think the first thing you need to know is that it's okay to have any kind of emotions, whether they're good emotions, like feeling happy or feeling silly, or whether they're the not so great emotions, you know, the being frustrated, the feeling angry, the feeling upset or sad. And it's okay to have those emotions and it's okay to process those emotions, but I think it's important to remember how your actions impact other people. Sometimes if you just take a deep breath, just process things for a second, you can always find something that will make you happy. So yeah, we all get frustrated. Yeah, we all get angry, but maybe if you just look around the room, there's something around you that could make you smile again. And sometimes that's all it takes to snap out of a mood, you know, because you're kind of in this zone of I'm mad about this, or I'm upset about this, or I'm frustrated about this. Oh wait, but I like that over there. That makes me smile. I think the world offers us so many beautiful things, whether it's the weather or whether it's just your favorite toy. And I think there's always something that can put a smile on your face. So sometimes it just takes a moment to take a deep breath and just find that thing that makes you happy again.
Thank you, Dylan. Rosie, this story helps us connect life experiences with emotions. Can you please explain the range of emotions you feel as you make art? What advice do you have for young artists about embracing the many emotions they feel as they create?
So as an artist, you have a lot of emotions going around when you're trying to create artwork. You can feel proud if it's going really well and it's exactly how you see in your head, even excited, but you can also feel nice and calm and very focused if you're really enjoying what you're doing, if you're thinking about it really hard. You can also feel frustrated if it's not really going the way you saw it in your head. And my advice would be to really take a break if it's not appearing how you think it's appearing in your head. Just like we see with Claire when she has to put her baseball game on hold because of the rain. You can't always tell when your brain's going to get a little bit foggy. And if that happens, you need to take a break, let it pass, and you'll be nice and clear again. And you'll see your artwork from a whole new perspective. And you'll be able to finish or carry on, and you'll feel much better.
Rosie, please describe how you learned to illustrate various types of clouds and weather experiences.
Yeah, so the first thing I do when I first get the brief for the Misty the Cloud books is I read the story again and again and lots more. And then I do loads of research on different types of clouds and different types of skies and what sort of colour the skies can be and what sort of weather has an impact on the colours of the skies. I also like to do tiny squares that are called thumbnails, and essentially they're just the pages in tiny form, so I can see the entire book laid out, and then I'll blow that up into full size and do the rough pencils. Then I'll start really thinking about the colours, doing some extra research and thinking about where we are in the story and what type of colours the skies can be in relation to the cloud characters, where the light's sort of hitting them, and how to really get creative with the colours and so the book flows through all a mix of colour palettes and different types of skies and clouds.
Rosie, the sky with all its sunbeams and clouds provides a full palette of colors that change based on the weather. Please show kids how they can create sky-colored art that has texture.
When creating the sky, the colors, they can be either a calm blue or a vibrant red or maybe even a yellow. Or a pink. You can be completely creative and open with what colours you like to use for your sky. And the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to start with a really nice blue colour. And for a stormy sky, just like in the Misty the Cloud books, I'd like it to be nice and textured and looking kind of rough. So I'm going to start with a paint stick. I'm going to go with blue on top of blue just to really get some depth in there. I'm going to just go right ahead and just colour the whole blue. And I'm going to leave some little gaps because I think it is going to create more texture. And then because it's a stormy colour, I'm also going to add some purple. In the Misty the Cloud books, I like to use lots of different colours on the skies. And these paint sticks are naturally full of texture, so you get a very stormy sky. And then I'm going to use some water just to smooth out some areas, and you can make it as smooth or as rough as you like, and you can even go in with some watercolor. I'm going to go in with a bright blue here, and what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take some ordinary salt so it's nice and covered with the salt there, and then I'm literally just going to dab it on my paint. And what that's going to do is make the painting even more rough and make the texture even more dramatic and rough. And I'd also like it to look like it's raining. So I really want to bring in some what look like sparkly kind of raindrops. And when you hold it up to the light, it looks, when it's dried, it looks really nice and sparkly. Next, I'm going to add some rain. And a really nice way of doing that is to load up your paintbrush with plenty of water and then grab a colour. Because it's quite a dark background for my stormy sky, I am going to use a little bit of white. And we get our paintbrush and we literally just flick it all over the page. And I absolutely love this technique. I've been doing this technique for years with painting. It looks like splatters of rain, all different types of raindrops. And just so it looks even more rainy, I'm going to add some lines so it looks like it's raining. And you might want to think about what the weather's like in your sky picture too. In my sky picture, the weather's raining, but you might like to have a nice sunny day in which you'd want nice smooth lines. And you could even paint some fluffy clouds as well. Now, I never resist putting sparkles in my artwork, especially in the Misty books. So I'm using a silver gel sparkle marker. I'm probably going to need to wait for this to dry a little bit before you go into it, but this area is quite dry, so what I'm going to do is just do some little spots where the rain lines are. So it looks like the light is catching all different specks of rain. So you end up with something really stormy and special. And you can do it with all different types of colours, and you can choose to make it as smooth or as rough as you like, depending on how you're feeling at the time. You might want to use some different colours. If you're feeling energetic, you might want to use reds or yellows or whatever that sort of means to you. But you're going to end up with something pretty special with this technique, especially with the salt.
Rosie, Misty's cloud friends each have a name that is rooted in science and implies its personality. Please demonstrate how to create a character whose personality and appearance are based on a science fact or insight.
So the Misty characters, I had to do lots of research on those of different types of clouds, and they're all based on a different type of cloud. So if we're thinking about Misty, who is my favourite one, she's based on a rain cloud. My favourite thing about this is that she is full of water, and that means I can use lots of different colours. And what I usually start to do, if you're taking Misty as an example, is take a slightly darker colour, and I'm going to illustrate her on a blue background with imagining a blue sky, but sometimes she appears on a yellow sky or a pink sky, depending on where she's in the story. But for now, I'm going to do blue. So I'm going to start with a blue outline. And what I'm going to do, starting with Misty, is just a circle for her head and then work out where the body's going to be. And then I'm going to just place in where her eyes would be, here. And a nose. And a mouth. And then I can start really adding the cloud bits in. And because Misty's quite a thick cloud, and she's a rain cloud, she's full of water, I like to use lots of round shapes so I can get lots of body to her hair. And when I was researching the clouds, what I was doing was seeing what sort of personality they would have based on the shape of them. So if you take someone like Wispy, he's based on a cirrus cloud, which is essentially a wispy cloud in the sky. So Misty has quite a few solid shapes in her body, because she's quite a solid cloud. But when you take someone like Wispy, I am going to use different types of strokes when I'm illustrating Wispy. So where Misty's like this kind of movement for the shapes. Wispy is more like this kind. So I'll do like a long line and then a few more cloud shapes. So he's a little bit longer in the lines. And he's really fun to draw because I was instantly imagining his personality to be something like quick and playful. He's zippy and light and imaginative and always wants to have fun. With him, I like to keep it really loose and he's got his goggles and he's got his hoverboard because he's always zipping around places. Misty, I imagined her as really creative and colourful and just full of personality. So she has little things about her too that hint to what sort of personality she would have. She has a beautiful, big, flowing, puffy skirt on, and I can just get to use a ton of colours for her eyes and her hair, and she has little star hair clips in. It's always lovely to see what sort of little things you can add to a character to add to their personality. Let's add some legs for Misty. That's it. And I always make her look like she's not quite standing. She's like kind of floating through the air. Okay, when you've got your basic outline and you've designed your character, it's time to colour. It's my favourite part of it. And what I usually do is think about where the light's coming from. So I'm going to pop the light right here in the top right corner, and I always mark it out with an arrow, just like that. And then when I know where the light's coming from, I take it to the other side where the shadow would be, and I just thicken those lines. Misty's really nice and big and thick cloud on that hair, so I put a nice big outline here. Lots of curves, lots of roundness, and it's starting to look really cloudy now, really fluffy. And then what I'm gonna do is, with Misty, because you can use lots of colours, because she's catching the light in all different directions because she's full of water, I'm going to use a little bit of pink just to add to that blue. And I'll always start from the side that the light is not coming from. I'm being quite scruffy because these are watercolour pencils and they have really fun twist about them that you can actually watercolour with them, which is one of my favourite things to do, and I've been using watercolour pencils for absolutely years. Now, where the light's going to be, I'm going to take some yellow, because I'm going to imagine that the sun's shining on her, which is what I usually do. If she's just hanging out in the sky or at home with friends on a typical sunny day, I'm just going to pop a little bit of yellow highlight there and maybe here. And then I'm going to go in with my brush and I'm just going to pull that colour out. It just looks really wonderful because what this lets you do is choose a starting point and you can build on it using the water as much or as little as you like. So I'm using just a little bit of water so I can still see the cloud lines, but you can just see where the shade starts, and also helps to get these lines looking really defined and a bit darker with still keeping the fluffy cloud. If you wanted to draw a little bit more of a wispier cloud, you could add a bit more water and make these kind of strokes. Just a little bit more airy and a bit more wispy. With Misty, I like to do circly strokes because they really get the fluffiness of the cloud. With Misty, you can use what we call negative space, where you haven't filled it with colour, but it still implies that something's there, it's solid, and that's really important with the clouds. Then we'll get a cleaner brush and just see what we can do with the highlight. So I'm gonna pull the highlight along. So she's looking thicker in this area with a little bit of light on her this side. And the great thing about it is you can just add as much or as little as you like. And there you can see how you can have a really nice bright light character, and I've used two completely different types of colours on one character. So if you are researching your own character, I would recommend seeing what sort of fun things you can find out about them. You can have loads of fun with what makes a certain part of nature unique. And that's exactly what I like to do with these cloud characters.
Rosie, thank you for helping kids blend their imaginations and science facts to create colorful skies and interesting characters that they can use in their own stories. We want to thank both Dylan and Rosie for sharing their insights about science, emotions, and art.
Thanks for having me, Mateo.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
And thank you to all the kids who have joined us today from around the world. Parents and teachers, be sure to check out more exciting learning ideas at crayola.com/creativityweek. And remember to share your kids' artwork so others can see their colorful skies and original illustrated stories. Use the hashtag Crayola Creativity Week for a chance to win the daily giveaway.